CIC Radio presents The Truth Denied, talk radio with your host, Roxy Lopez, where truth never lies. If you would like to speak with Roxy on the air, the call-in number is 347-327-9997. Here she is, your host, Roxy Lopez.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's high noon in the desert, and we're live today. This is the Truth Denied Talk Radio. I'll be your host today, Roxy Lopez. I just wanted to say briefly, I want to thank everybody for their support. We're getting a lot of emails at the Truth Denied. The new website is really coming along quite well. We're really reaching millions of people now, and I want to thank the webmasters for their mass experience in doing this. They're just tremendous. I want to thank all the listeners who just continue to show up to the shows today. We had quite a few, and we have quite a few who clicked attending on the event for the show today. And you should, because I'll tell you, our guest today is Barabra Peterson of Farm Wars. And for those of you who are not too familiar with Farm Wars really covers a lot of investigation. And Barabra is a tremendous plethora of information herself. I remember when I first met Barabra Peterson, I was doing some investigating on the Space Preservation Act. And Barabra and I got on the phone. I was about to enter a grocery store, and I ended up standing in the parking lot and talking to Barabra for about 2 hours on the phone about the Space Preservation Act. And but their site covers anything from transhumanism, which is something that a lot of you don't know about, nanotechnology, synthetic life forms, otherwise known as SYNTHIA, Corexic spraying, flesh-eating bacteria, Morgellons disease, and the changing of the human DNA. I mean, it really covers a lot. And, of course, the umbrella of chemtrails. She is an advocate for all of us who are fighting against these crimes against humanity. And I would like to also say Barabra is very, very experienced. She has a great background, and I hope that she'll explain her background to us today. And if any of you have any questions in the chat room, et cetera, go ahead and throw those questions out there, and we will try to get those questions to Barabra. If you're going to call in, please wait until the half-hour mark, and the number is 347-327-9997. Hello, Barabra Peterson. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Roxy. Good to be here.
Oh, good. I'm glad. Now, you were just saying a moment ago when we were talking off the air that you were on another show.
Oh, I was on the Dave Hodges show, the Common Sense show, just a little while ago, and we were talking about some of the same information. He's doing some in-depth investigative reporting about Corexit, BP, and then as we got into it, we started putting together connecting the dots between this nanotechnology, SYNTHIA, the BP oil spill, you know, and all that stuff. So it was quite interesting, but we had some interesting technical difficulties too.
Oh, well, let's see if we can get through a show. You know, we do all tend to have those issues, and with the age of technology at our beckoning at our door. Barabra, where did this all start for you as far as – I know that you had mentioned that Farm Wars is about 2 years old, but where did this critical thinking begin for you?
Well, I'll tell you, I used to work for the Department of Corrections, Folsom Prison, and I worked there for about 10 years, and I'd had enough. After you work in an environment like that for a certain length of time, the change becomes irreversible, and you become whatever it is, you know, that they spit out. It's not good.
Right. What do you mean by that? Just real briefly, what do you mean by that? Department of Corrections, what were you dealing with for 10 years?
I was a guard.
Oh, wow.
In Old Folsom, not New Folsom, Old Folsom Prison. And that's, I went in there in 1986, and that I was one of the first women in the guard classification, correctional officer, excuse me, that's the politically correct term to use. We called ourselves guards. But it was something that I, you know, it's kind of interesting how I got into it. I had just gotten a divorce, and I needed to earn money to support my horse.
Oh.
And I didn't have a college education, and I looked through to see what kind of job I could get that I would make a minimum of a certain amount per month and that I could actually qualify for. And so I looked over, you know, police officer, and I said, well, this doesn't look too hard. So I started working out at Gold's Gym and training and running 3 miles a day and everything, and I went through all this everything. I got on list upon list upon list, and finally the Department of Corrections seemed to have higher pay, and it was local, and I took that one. And when I got in there, I realized, well, this is kind of an odd place to work, but it's an interesting building, so I think I'll just tough it out. Because when you go in, they take you into a little room, and they show you all of the weapons that the inmates have in their cells and all that, because this was a maximum security facility. Mm-hmm. It didn't have a death row in it, because they had taken that out and put it in San Quentin. So Folsom no longer had a death row, but we still had all the lifers, all the guys that were in there for, you know, mass murders and all this stuff. Manson was there right before I got there. Fortunately, he was gone when I was there. So we had all of that. And the thing is, when you're dealing with a situation like that, every day you're walking the tears. Every day you're and I walked the tears. I did a gun walk when I first got there, but I preferred to be on the floor. I'm kind of a people person. And when you go through that, and the things that you see we had incidents at least 3 to 4 times a week, sometimes 3 times in a day, stabbings, shots fired, you would not believe the kind of stuff. Having urine thrown at you, feces thrown at you. It gets to the point where you change. You don't walk into a, you don't wear a uniform outside of the prison. You don't walk into a restaurant without finding a chair next, you know, with your back to a wall facing the doors. And my mother, who was alive at the time, she happened to mention, Barbara, you've really changed. And after 10 years, I thought, you know what, I can get out of here with something of a retirement and maybe buy some land and, you know, get out. Or I can wait for another 10 years and who knows what I'm going to morph into, because I saw the 20-year people in there. And I'm telling you, you didn't want to be around them. The only people that they could even relate to were other guards.
Oh, my.
You can't relate to other people. You just can't. You're changed. It's almost like it's genetic. I don't know, but it changes you. I had to get out. Got out, moved to Oregon, then took care of my mother and decided to go to school online for a business degree, maybe a computer business or something like that, I thought. And as I went to school, I realized that most of the people going through the school really were just doing it to get the degree. I was actually doing it to learn something. And I did learn something. It wasn't necessarily what they wanted me to learn. But I learned the mechanics of the business community. I understand marketing. I understand how it happens, what it is. We even had a class on, you know, propaganda. Is it good or bad? And basically boiled down to it depends on how you use it, because everything's propaganda. You know, so that's what I went into school. Then I decided I was going to write. So I started writing for op-ed news. I started getting interested in food. And I started learning about Monsanto. And that was really kind of my first thing. And when I started realizing that, I just went, oh, my goodness. Well, what else are they lying to us about? And I had this, you know, sinking feeling in the pit of my stomach that nothing is as it seems. Everything is, you know, just about everything you're being told is a lie. Nothing is as it seems. So I started doing the digging, and I did Speak Truth to Power at WordPress, and started posting things there and digging more and more and more. And then I realized that our economy is collapsing in free fall speed. And I put up Surviving the Middle Class Crash, and I started collecting all sorts of resources for people, how to forage, how to build a shelter out of pallets, how to put a little, you know, covering over food and grow it, how to, things like that, just to survive. Because I saw what was going down. I saw what was happening. And then shortly after, all these people, now they're on the streets. And it's ridiculous. I just want to put up some resources. And then Marty Oakley and I started talking. She has the PPJ Gazette. We're partners. And I decided, well, we're going to do farm wars and concentrate on this genetic application of it, which is interesting because when I was a kid, I wouldn't even dissect a frog. I walked out of the room. And then I found myself talking with our Podpustai's wife and partner, Susan, about genetic engineering and the actual, I wanted to know what the actual process was and why it was dangerous, and I found out. And that's when I created Aggie, the traveling agrobacterium, started going full force on farm wars. And since then, it's morphed into a lot more because there is a lot of stuff that's affecting us. It's affecting our food. It's affecting the animals around us. And it seems to be all one huge storm. We've got genetic engineering. We've got chemtrails. We've got nanotechnology. And we've got Obamacare. Does Obamacare have to do with it? Well, let's see. We have Operation Paperclip, where the guys that were doing all these horrendous experiments on people actually got, you know, oh, come on over to the United States. We really like you. The United States probably instigated all that, too. Now, we've got these people over here. Do we think we're actually going to quit the experimentation? I don't think so. Because, quite frankly, why should they? They've got being backed by people with enough money. Now, that they can do it. See, I've worked in a prison. I worked with psychopaths on both sides of the aisle. And one thing I know is that if a person, I compare the what they call global elite, the people with all this money, I compare them to the inmates in a prison. And the reason I do that is because the mentality is the same. These people have so much money. They don't have, they can spend 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, thinking about how they're going to make life better for themselves, collect more goodies, and basically take over the world. If it wasn't for us pesky people. Inmates do the same thing, except they don't really have any money, but they have all the time in the world because that's all they have. And they have all the time in the world to think about how they are going to get over on you. And they have their own little drug smuggling, you know, underground things and everything. You will not believe what goes on in there. And they have, because they have all the time in the world to figure out how to play their games and how to do this. And it's the same thing. And that's why I compare them. And I'm really positive that they're happy about me doing that, but it's the truth. So if you think, if you understand that that's where they're coming from, that these are people with, anybody who would put an untested, untried on humans, on anything, genetically modified food into circulation and try and push it on the world and then deny the independent science stating, hey, this could be dangerous.
And that's what I wanted to ask you, because a lot of people do ask. You know, they're well aware now that GMOs are out there. They're well aware of the FDA not approving labeling to discern the difference between, you know, for shoppers, the difference between a genetically modified product and a non or a organic or certified organic. And, of course, we can go into the certified organic. But can we talk about, from your perspective and what you found out, what is a GMO and what is the problem with a GMO? What is the problem with genetically modified seeds? What is the difference? What have we done to our farming communities? What have we done to our food? And how is it affecting human consumption? When we're consuming these types of food, what is it doing to us? Can we talk about that for a little bit?
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. Okay. It's such a big subject. And first, yeah, the genetically modified food, how it affects us physically. Okay, let's go to how it's made.
Okay.
Genetic engineering. We call everything genetically modified, but the actual correct term is genetically engineered in a laboratory. Okay. If you have, they're calling genetic modification, oh, well, we've been modifying genes for a long time. No, what you've been doing is traditional breeding that has modified the end product of the plant. Say, you know, oh, okay, you do traditional breeding, you pollinate here, you do whatever. That's traditional. And yes, we have changed things.
And would traditional be like hybriding?
Yeah, I'm not a fan of hybrids for seed saving at this point, but anyway, well, that's another story. But the genetic modification, the genetic engineering is the problem. Now, what we have is when they go in and genetically engineer something, they take the it's DNA. They take foreign DNA. Say you're going to have, you want a tomato to last longer. You want it to be able to be shipped from one end of the country to the other end of the country and sit in the grocer's shelf in case somebody doesn't buy it, you know, for 3 days and still have it look good, be firm, and look like something somebody wants to buy.
Mm-hmm.
So what do? You take a fish gene and you put it into that cell and you grow yourself a brand new, what appears to be food, which is combining. It's like combining a horse and a rabbit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to combine a horse and a rabbit genes to see what I can find out, see what I can get, which is they're doing that with animals now too. But when you do it and you do it in our food supply, this is what happens. That foreign DNA that you're putting inside that cell to, quote, express something like insecticide or drought tolerance or cold tolerance or something like that, that DNA is not completely digested in the gut. It has been shown now, and Dr. Maewon Ho from ISIS, Institute of Science and Society, has written a paper, and I've posted it on FarmWars. It's pretty heavy reading. You have to kind of go through it one paragraph at a time, and at least I did, and just decipher it. But basically, what they found, I believe it was China researcher, has proven that circulating nucleic acids, which are RNA and DNA,
mm-hmm.
which is what the DNA is, which what is modified in the food, it can pass through into your bloodstream. They have found people that have eaten a particular type of rice, and they found the rice nucleic acids, a particular one, circulating through people's bloodstreams after they have eaten this rice. Nothing. They have done absolutely no research whatsoever, except for all this independent research, about what happens when the DNA of a genetically modified plant starts circulating through your bloodstream.
Now, has there been a question... Because as you're saying all of this, my head's going somewhere right now. And mm-hmm. let me see if I can get this right. Has anyone considered that the genetically engineered DNA, that foreign DNA that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
has anyone considered that that could mutate, number one? And obviously what you're explaining right now is food that's not fit for human consumption.
Right.
All right, A, B. But if that DNA mutates, and then we're seeing that in the bloodstream, I mean, what are we talking about here? Are we talking about actually beginning to also mutate the human DNA?
Yes.
Okay. Interesting.
Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Oh, my Lord.
Right. And the thing is, they're doing this. And whether they're doing it because, quite frankly, they just want to make a profit and don't care, or they're using the new database that will be put up through Obamacare and collecting all of the statistics. Because if you're going to do an experiment, what you want to do is you want to collect your statistical data. Now, how are you going to do that? You have to have a big enough database that all of the data is collected in it. You do that through the doctors and the hospitals. Mm-hmm. So you collect all that data and you determine what illnesses are happening in what areas. Then you go ahead and you compare that with what's being done, Now, I'm not saying this is happening. I'm just saying that this is a possibility, because all this stuff, as you know, as you go through it, you get an inkling, and then you have to go ahead and backtrace and try and prove everything that you believe is happening, that they could be doing this. You know, and I'm a hard one with believing in coincidence. I really have a hard time with that. So the change, whatever changes they're looking for, okay, if somebody, these guys in the, I believe it was IG Farben, I was just corrected a little while ago by Nicole, when and she said it was IG Farben that went and did the, I guess funded or was basically in charge for the experiments in the concentration camps. But they didn't care. They took people. They had enough people. And the people, if you dehumanize people and you just consider them as a number, you take these people and then you put them through experiments, and you really don't care. All you want to do is, hey, I want to find out if this particular protein causes excessive bleeding. Oh.
Right.
Okay, who can we experiment on?
It's the proverbial guinea pig scenario, and humans are part of that whole guinea pigging. And I think for you and I both, with the work that we do, I think what makes me personally more irate than anything else is the secrecy behind it. See, I don't think a lot of us would have any problems, for instance, with the chemtrails. If they were open and just instead of us playing back engineering on this, all of this crap, just came right out in the open, and they're not going to come out in the open. And I actually think that, you know, even prior to, I think that the secrecies of this type of this nature have been going on forever and ever and ever. There's always been a select few that know everything, and then the rest of us don't.
Yeah, but why do you keep a secret? What is the main reason for keeping a secret?
Oh, because the human beings are you know, humans are, you know, we'll gossip, we'll overreact, we're crazy, we'll cause riots and so forth. So, you know, we're just not worthy of it anyway, because we don't understand it, and it's really above our learning curve. So just not tell us at all. Which, you know, this is why we're all in this business today. This is why we are, you know, you and I and many other camps are bringing awareness to our societies, because we're just over it. And you know, you said something earlier in the show that this is a storm now of we are seriously being bombarded by so much poison in our water, in our food, in our air, even the building materials of new homes. I mean, clothing, it just goes on and on and on, doesn't it? And we're just being lied to. Now back to the whole GMO aspect. You know, you're a farmer. You have a small farm. You raise animals. I imagine you grow food as well. Do you grow some food? All right. So what are you experiencing? How are you taking all of this out of the loop so that your animals and the food that you're growing is not poisonous? How are you surviving?
Well, I'll tell you, I'm kind of on a limited income here because there's a lot of things I would love to do that I simply can't. But the things that I am doing are my horses. I've got an old-time farmer a few miles away who doesn't use any pesticides or doesn't use anything like that on his grass hay, and he just bales it, and then I'll go get it, and they're getting fed that. The thing that I can't control is what's being dumped out of the sky. Aluminum can be mitigated with lime. There are other things to do because I'm assuming I'm going to be contaminated, and I'm assuming my animals are going to be contaminated. So what I have to do is try and lessen the contamination. I do that by not eating processed food from the store that is 85% GMO and loaded with pesticides. I can't afford the USDA certified organic stuff, and they don't guarantee they don't have GMOs in them either.
Right.
I don't care what anybody says. Even the NOP program admits it. There's no threshold for GMOs. So I do that, and I also have zeolite and iodine. And I'm taking another spirulina type of thing too, to cleanse my system. Since I know I'm going to be contaminated, then I just do a continual cleansing on my system. And my animals, I'm worming them with diatomaceous earth, which cleans out the system too. And we haven't been able to put up a greenhouse or anything outside, so that's still out in the open. But I am working on an indoor garden room, and it's going to take me a while to figure that out because I have to figure out the I have to hand pollinate. When you've got an indoor garden, you have to hand pollinate. And I got to learn how to do that, but I need to because if you take a look around, you see sick people. I go to the store. What do you see? You see a whole bunch of people that are completely obese with their shopping cart stuffed with all this stuff, and they're sick. If you have a circle of friends, I will bet you dollars to donuts that most of them are sick. They've got some sort of illness, some sort of something wrong with them. When I was a kid, that wasn't normal. It was normal to be healthy.
I notice a lot of different things, and heavy metal poisoning seems to be the culprit for a lot of people. I know in this region, they don't know they have it. They don't get tested for it. But you're right. Anything like this, in my opinion and from my research, is especially the aluminum, it is breaking down our immune systems, and that leaves us prey for viruses or colds or upper respiratory illnesses or, you know, new forms of, you know, food allergies, lots of different allergies going on too. So, and where is it all coming from? You know, that's not all coming from the chemtrails, but what is flesh-eating bacteria? What is that about, Barbara?
That is this Mike Edwards, or Edward, he has a very, very, very good article about that. And we're trying to figure out, and I'm pretty sure, you know, this is it, but I'm not going to go ahead and bet my life on it. But Craig Venter, he has synthetic genomics. Now, BP, British Petroleum, they actually did a partnership with synthetic genomics. And what they were developing is a some sort of synthetic life that could go in and make the oil be more fluid, using it as a surfactant to make the oil more fluid so it will come out of the ground easier and quicker. Well, it worked. And then what they're experiencing in the Gulf was this blue plague where people were having their, or still are, I believe, it's the flesh being eaten. So the question is this partnership between Venter, who created SYNTHIA and mapped the human genome, is he that research that they were doing that I'm certain BP was using, is that level two of SYNTHIA being set loose in the Gulf to eat, supposedly eat up the oil, and has developed an appetite for other things? So and it's self-replicating. That's how Venter developed SYNTHIA, to be self-replicating. So triggers.
Now, I do know a little bit about, I had a couple of scientists approach me during the Gulf oil spill, and they wanted to put something into the water that would, I don't recall the name of it, but that would, you know, what you're describing would eat the oil, you know, out of the water. And are we talking about the same two things here? Are we talking, and when you're talking about synthetic genomics?
Synthetic genomics. That's Craig Venter's site. And I could actually give you the URL.
Yeah.
It's syntheticgenomics.com. SYNTHETICGENOMICS.com.
What is the gentleman's name? Greg?
Greg Venter.
Venter. Interesting. I did deal with a person named Greg, but I don't recall the last name. That's the person who approached us and wanted to have us put it on our website and this and that and encourage people in the Gulf. Interesting. I don't even know if there's a connection with this. Okay, so I also know that, with this flesh-eating bacteria, and I have seen some of the photos, I have read some information about it. I don't understand the depths of it. It appears to be like almost like where people get sores on their skin, and those sores just grow and grow and grow. It's kind of like a staph infection, maybe, to the 70s. Remember staph infections, where you get a little tiny sore on your skin, and then it would just grow and grow and grow. I know I had one on the back of my heel when I was about 11 years old, and it took months it just kept digging a hole deeper and deeper and deeper. It had nothing to do with my hygiene. It just, and the doctor could put me on antibiotics, and it just dug a hole. And I have a really sizable scar there on the back of my heel, on the top by the ankle, and it was kind of scary because it just never went away. Is this like, I was reading about a year and a half ago that staph infections were reoccurring. So is this anything to do with staph, you think? This flesh-eating bacteria?
When you develop something that's synthetic that has no known boundaries in the natural, then anything is possible.
Right. Well, again, we get back into mutation, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
Something that mutates. For instance, the antibiotics, they had to keep beefing up the antibiotics because the bug would beef up, and then the antibiotic couldn't handle it anymore, which is a whole other interesting story. Now, what about Morgellons? Because there are a couple of people down in the Gulf that are also saying that they're getting, studying Morgellons disease, that seems to be popping up. Are they confusing the two, you think, the flesh-eating bacteria with the Morgellons?
No. This is when we get into nanotechnology, I believe.
Okay.
Nanotechnology is like 1 to 100 nanometers big, and the size of that is down to the atomic and molecular level. Okay? It's just so tiny. Nanotechnology is relatively unregulated. as my kind of focus is on the food, I called up the National Organics Program and I asked them about nanotechnology. Have they doing anything to regulate that? Because I ran across several things, like in 2010, saying we suggest that we have no nanotechnology in organic food. Well, here it is, 2011. And I said, what have you done? And they said, well, we really can't figure out how to define nanotechnology, but don't worry, don't worry. We haven't heard of any nanotechnology being used in organic food. Well, that, of course, made me extremely comfortable. So, nanotechnology is everywhere. In Weather as a Force Multiplier 2025,
mm-hmm.
they can be spraying that, and it even talks about it, about nanotechnology being used, being sprayed. Okay? Now, if they're spraying all this stuff around, they're putting it in our food without us knowing it. They can use it as a use it for flavor enhancement, for anything they want in the food. They don't have to say anything about it being there because it's too small. It is in under the wire, way too small. But what happens? What happens? And nobody has answered this question yet. What happens when all of these nanobots, all of this stuff combine? You're flooded with them on the outside. You're flooded with them on the inside. Now, what happens if your system has a reaction? How is that reaction going to manifest? Well, I'll tell you how it can manifest. I personally had an experience.
Okay.
It was I think it was about 2 years ago. I had pictures of my leg when it started, but my computer crashed. I don't have them anymore. This happened with my mother first. Evidently, there's a genetic, we all know, genetic predispositions run in family lines. So she was genetically predisposed to have a sensitivity towards whatever had this happen, and then I got it too. Started out with a small lesion on the outside of my right leg. Have you ever seen a very, very bad case of poison oak?
Yes, I have.
Real oozy, big
yes.
red bumps. And oh, just, that's how it started. And it itched. Oh, it itched so bad. And then it spread. And it engulfed my leg. And then it went up that leg, up to my shoulders, across my shoulders, down the other leg. I couldn't sleep. I was up constantly, scratching, itching, scratching, scratching. And I know that the doctors didn't know what it was because my mother went through the same thing. And I had her go through all sorts of medical tests because she had the insurance to cover it. And you know what the specialist gave her?
Hmm.
A prescription for vaginal fungal cream.
Hmm.
Which I used on her, and it didn't work.
Right.
So,
and now was this cream supposed to be put on her arms and legs and everything as well?
Wherever the lesion.
Okay. All right.
That's where she was supposed to put it, but it didn't work. Of course, antibiotics didn't work. They kept giving her stronger and stronger antibiotics. So I decided I wasn't going to go through that. I finally got her to where she was on a raw food diet, just uh-huh. steamed lightly and stuff like that. She got over it. Mm-hmm. But I didn't equate it to GMOs. I wasn't thinking like that till I got it.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was afraid to eat.
Mm-hmm.
I literally drank water, and then I wouldn't itch so bad. So then I cut out every bit of food, and I started introducing food one at a time. I lost 60 pounds. As I introduced a food to my diet, I would wait and see if something would, you know, if I'd start itching.
Mm-hmm.
If I'd start itching, I'd cut it out, take another food, until I determined that every single thing that I ate that was had the possibility of having GMOs in it, I itched. Every time.
Wow. So you were actually having a full-on allergic reaction to GMOs, sounds
yes.
like. What does GMO stand for, Barbara?
Oh, genetically modified organisms, the genetically engineered
okay.
foods, mm-hmm. which, you know, when they start delving into life, they're using nanotechnology, using genetic engineering modification, when they start delving into that and they start rearranging the basic building blocks of life and changing them around, the consequences are something that cannot be controlled. And they don't know all of the consequences of it, yet they're doing it anyway. The principle of first do no harm has been thrown out the window. And when the doctor looks at you and says, well, I don't have a clue, and you have to find out for yourself what's wrong. I've been itch-free ever since I stopped eating GMOs. Now, what's going to happen when, you know, all of these things start combining in our system? Yeah, Morgellons? Yeah. I can actually see that as a possible side effect of nanotechnology. Because these things, and then if you combine that with self-replication of the SYNTHIA, mm-hmm. the synthetic organism, I mean, why isn't somebody looking into it? Why isn't somebody looking into these darn fibers and saying, excuse me, this is nothing like what comes out of a human body?
Right.
Why
the
is
synthetic
it there?
Fibers that exactly. Why is it there? How did it get there? And then cause and effect that we don't even know the extent of. You're absolutely right. We have somebody in Cyprus, Caroline Carter, who's a doctor who also has Morgellons and has been studying it for roughly 6 years. She has an incredible biology background and as a biologist for a company back in the UK. It's why she left. Very similar to what happened to you. Is, you know, we all have a very similar story that something changed us and we wanted to start looking into a certain area, and before you know it, we're all covering these umbrella areas of not only toxicity, but some really crazy Frankenstein going on, as far as I'm concerned. And, like, you know, even if we look back at our recent history before we even discovered some of this, you know, Morgellons, et cetera, you know, what about mad cow disease? I mean, look at what happened in Europe. I mean, it was astounding. They were, you know, forced to put down, you know, burn livestock. I mean, just burn mm-hmm. cows. And it was sad. I remember when I watched some of the footage on something like CNN or whatever, and I remember thinking, what a waste of life, you know, when they were just these bulldozers just dropping in the thousands and thousands of these live cows. I remember even asking, are they alive when they're dropping them into these fire pits? You know, I was so concerned on so many different levels for the animal itself, and then for the actual mad cow, what is it? And the idea that it could jump, you know, species, you know, go from an animal to human. I mean, we just hadn't had that prior. And of course, after the fact that mad cow was, you know, look, it was a huge storm, and then it just went away. I mean, we don't really talk about mad cow disease anymore. You know,
yeah.
we don't bring it up anymore. And I don't even mm-hmm. know if it still exists, but we just don't talk about it. And by the way, just regarding public health matters, about a month ago, well, actually it was back in May, Center for Disease Control and Prevention put out a Preparedness 101 Zombie Apocalypse. I did a write-up on it. And I thought, is this like a joke? You know, on the CDC. But they went down the line on this whole zombie apocalypse and what could happen. You know, human beings turning into zombies and calling it like it could be a natural disaster. And the whole CDC emergency page lists what you should do, you know, including water and food and medication and tools and supplies and this and that, blah, 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 in the case of a zombie apocalypse. What the hell are they doing?
Jeez.
Yeah, did
zombie
you know this?
No,
yeah,
no.
Zombie. I did a whole write-up on it, and I just thought, is this like a joke? You know? And, of course, they were talking about, you know, floods and this and that, blah, blah, blah. But, I mean, it's called Preparedness 101, zombie apocalypse. And what you've got a good. I'll send you a link to it.
Thank you.
I went further down the road on it, but not only are they talking about things like this and isolation and quarantines and infection control. I mean, it really gets into stuff like the movie Contagion. I don't know if you saw the movie, but
oh yeah,
I
saw it.
Okay, I did too. And you know, they talk about Morgellons in that, and that. I mean, this whole viral outbreak, and this is right on the CDC, and they're serious. The federal agencies, the medical teams, the first responders all have the memo. Okay, and I'm thinking, no, this is like a joke, right? But not only that, they also put out about a couple of months ago, which I was surprised because we've been all waiting for it. They are doing studies on Morgellons now. They're not calling it Morgellons, but all the symptoms are Morgellons, and they're only doing the study in Northern California. They are now asking for Morgellons sufferers. They're wanting to take a look at it, the CDC. When I'm telling you, when a year ago, you know, there Morgellons was... You know, you talked about your mother getting a vaginal cream for her, sores on her skin. Well, what they were doing prior to that is they were sending people to a psychologist and giving them something to dumb them down and put them out. They, you know, basically saying to the patient that the patient was the cause of these sores on the body. The patient was the cause. And they would not test the fibers growing out of any patient. They wouldn't test the skin. They wouldn't test anything. They just basically claimed crazy on the patient and sent them to a psychologist to get them some antidepressants and so forth and so forth. So and basically go away. This disease does not exist. And it does exist. By the way, back to the CDC on that, it is interesting that if you read some of what they term as a zombie, they talk about the mutation and et cetera, et cetera. So where are we going? And is our, let's say in our country, the National Guard, are they gearing up for something like this? Is it possible that, not in all sense of the word zombie, but is it possible that people could start losing their minds and creating some sort of apocalyptic, revolution that really has nothing to do with the revolution of those who are sensical or like Occupy Wall Street, things like that. Is it possible? I mean, they have something out called the Zombie Survival Guide.
Oh my! I've gotta see that. That is just.
And it refers to a condition of ataxic neurodegenerative satiety deficiency syndrome, otherwise known as zombieism. I mean, come on.
Oh my goodness.
It's not a joke, you know, and they do refer to other mutations. They actually state, you know, mutations of things such as in the prisons, they mention. I don't even know what they're talking about. And then they talk about mutations of existing conditions such as prions, mad cow disease, measles, and rabies. So, yeah, I'll send you a link to it. And anybody that wants it, I'll put it into this interview as well because, Barbara, we always release an interview – our interviews with some photos and your website, your contact information, all of that. We put that on our website. We put that on our YouTube channel. And then we have that going on infinitum, you know, for you, for promotion for your website and things like that. So in essence, you're very welcome and thank you. We've got 10 minutes left on the show. I don't know how this went so fast, but if there's anything that you want to say, I'd say it now for the listening audience. Transhumanism. Can you talk about transhumanism for 5 more minutes?
What I wanted to know is the end game. Why?
Okay.
It seems that certain people with enough money, who are the rich elite, tend to have a transhumanist agenda. Now, that agenda is called the singularity. This is where technology and humans merge to form a post-human. So this is, in my way of thinking, what they're headed for. They want to create super soldiers. They want to live forever. They want to take your brain and stick it on a computer chip, which is what they've done with SYNTHIA. That's how they've got her that on a computer chip, and that's going to synthetic biology, which is a stepping stone towards the transhumanism, their change. Okay, this is what I believe that they're going for. I've got documents to prove it. And they, as far as I'm concerned, all this other stuff that they're doing with everything else, the perfect storm here is the experiment. Because that's how they want to change themselves. They want to be go to the singularity. They want to have a perfect world where they have no sickness because they're melded with machines. They want a chip in their brain as big as a blood cell so they can access real time data. So that you can have access to maybe all the data in the world. Just think a thought. This is where they want to go. That's where they're pushing us, I believe.
And so I understand that end of it, you know, and that makes total sense. You know, basically turn us in. We're already slaves. Let's just turn us into robots, and then we're more robust, more proficient, more this, more that. But what about the other angle of this, where there are a lot of people saying that this is genocidal as well, that they want to reduce the population of the world. Mm-hmm. Do they want to take some? So basically, they're experimenting. Those who died, who cares? Those who survive, good, we want to use you. You're hired. Mm-hmm. The ones who die, you're fired. It's basically that simple.
My way of thinking.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. And in the interim, there is probably some sort of scientific understanding that there are going to be many who die simply because we don't know the effects, and the effects don't look too good anyway. So as we're testing on the population, we are just like anything else. We're a guinea pig. It doesn't matter. We're bottom feeders anyway. We just really basically, like you said, the super soldier, the superhuman, the super producer.
Mm-hmm.
And everything else that goes away fits into the scheme of survival of the fittest.
Yes.
Which, I think they're wrong, because we're also we're at a time on the planet where we're humans, and maybe it's the whole entire planet all at once. Maybe it's inclusive of animals and all life on the planet. We're heading right for, you know, while they're having this superstorm, this global superstorm of crap, we're also in for a quantum leap as well. And we're in for an evolution. So this is an interesting dichotomy, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like they're trying to snuff us out before we have this evolution.
Well, the evolution is only for a certain few people that can afford it.
Well, I'm talking about a spiritual evolution. I'm talking about a human evolution, a spiritual evolution where we are actually growing as humans. We're due for that evolution. We are due for an evolution. So is it possible that science versus this spiritual evolution, almost like a war? Almost like, not to sound too strange or biblical, but almost like a war between good and evil.
Well, it's a replacement. It's a replacement. You have the
this is a sci-fi version, right?
Yeah, you got the sci-fi version. You got the Captain Kirk version, who happens to be a transhumanist. And which is the replicant, the actual, it isn't even a good replicant, of what actually we're experiencing on, say, a spiritual level. And so we've got the phony, and then we've got the real. And the phony always wants to overtake the real. So it is a battle back and forth. In my opinion, there's people that do things with good intentions, that they want to do everything for good, and there's people that will take those same things and, well, we're going to do it for this because we can those who die with the most toys win. So I'm going to have the most toys.
And you described it from 10 years in the prison world. You're talking about psychopaths, and psychopaths have no conscience. It's like you said, it's a win-win who has the most toys, and the rest of it goes by the wayside. They actually believe, well, they're narcissists.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, they believe in themselves and their own vision, and that's it, and that's the whole perspective of the entire world. What's the cure? What do we do? What are you doing? I know you're creating awareness. What can I do for you to further that awareness, Barabra? I know we can point people towards you. How can people get in touch with you? I know that your website is FarmWars. I love it. We will advertise it for you. How would you like people to contact you if they have questions about this show?
You can contact me at barb@farmwars.info. You can go on my Facebook page. It's Farm Wars. It's you can join by going to my site, and then I have a little badge there you can click, and I discuss and back and forth discussions about all this stuff, trying to figure out how we can survive this thing. At least we're not going to get out of this alive. This is the world. This is we're going to die. The point is, how are you going to go out? How are you going to do it? I personally am advocating a garden in every home. If you have to grow anything, learn how to do it now. Save your seeds. Make yourself and your family as healthy as you possibly can. Just that's one of the most important things that I could possibly stress.
Pass on. It's very important. I agree with you. And I might want to add, don't go out and buy GMO seeds, people. Go out and buy organic seeds when you're going to be growing. That's another one. You see it at all the Home Depots and Lowe's, and you think you're getting this big, giant, tomato plant. It's a GMO plant.
Or it's a hybrid.
Or it's a hybrid, exactly.
In which case, you can't save the seed for the next planting.
Exactly.
And that's what you
and
want.
And that's why I'm saying to people, definitely get yourself organic. Well, Barabra, listen, we're going to let you go. We're going to wrap this up here. Barabra H. Peterson from Farm Wars. Barabra, thank you so much for joining us on the show, and we definitely will be speaking again very soon.
It was fun, Roxy. Glad to be here.
But glad you could make it. Take care. Say hi to your horses.
I will.
Okay. Thanks, Barabra. Speak to you soon.
Bye-bye now.
So that was Barabra Peterson from Farm Wars, amazing woman. And, hey, listen, on Monday, the Just Bernard Show is good. Magical practitioner Courtney Davis. So she will be joining Bernard and Yvonne on the GIC radio this Monday to discuss the Merlin energy. And that is just – that's magical right there, Merlin energy, just hearing it. And again, we will have the archive of the video of this show up. I want to thank the GIC for providing us a platform every week, every Friday, noon, live in the Arizona desert. We are the truth denied, where the truth never lies. I'm ever so grateful for the listeners and those of you who have been supporting us, sending in donations, etc. We appreciate it more than you know. And I am your host, Roxy Lopez. Please have a safe weekend. And when all else fails, smile. Thank you.